Today is a very interesting topic before us, is to discuss the Vishuddhi Jal, which is placed here behind the base of the neck and which has got 16 beds. It manifests outside the survival places in the clothes for physical action. As you know, for the emotional side, we have got adaptors to lines, and thyroid is the gland which is placed here. This center in the evolution is of greatest importance for human beings, because this center develops its maximum growth when human beings raise their heads from animal stage to become human beings. As animals, the heads were at an angle towards the ground. First it was just touching, parallel. Then it was raised higher and higher, till it came to monkey stage, where it was raised slightly higher. And at the human stage only, they raised their heads in a straight line. Straight line was all right. Till the straight line, it was the balance between the superego and the ego. First there is superego in the animals, when they are looked after by human beings. Animals develop certain conditionings from human beings. Like a dog has to be looked after by human beings. Then the dog is told to do this or that, and the conditioning starts. And when this conditioning starts in a dog, he starts developing his superego in a human way. But when a chimpanzee raised his head and tried to become a man, first the head of the first original man was bent like this. In the Ramayana, there is a mention of such race, the missing race, where human beings were half monkeys and half human beings. That's about 8,000 years back. Now this center was really fully enlightened by Sri Krishna, who came on this earth in the era called as Dwapara. Rama was in Satyuga and he came in Dwapara. That is about 6,000 years back. And Sri Krishna incarnated as one of the incarnations of Sri Vishnu, who is responsible for our evolutionary process. It is only through Sri Vishnu that we evolve. He is the aspect which gives us dharma. Dharma is our sustenance. Through changing our sustenances or our capacities, we have evolved. Like I can say, carbon was at Muladhara Chakra. And this carbon, the cheap matter, got prana into it, by which it started growing as a living thing. This living thing then grew into higher and higher awareness, till you reached a stage where you were an animal, and then you had to become a human being. The first human beings were shock people. That incarnations of the shock people is called as Vamana. Then there were people who became very conscious of the nature around, and they wanted to have the mastery over the nature. They started doing all kinds of yagyas according to the Vedas. Vedas actually worked out right-hand side both of human beings, and they developed people who were good at reciting Veda mantras and all such things that would give us mastery over the five elements. These people, when they master the five elements, they become very ego-oriented. And instead of only keeping the head in the center, they started pulling it backwards. By pulling it backwards, they started developing their pituitary. And this pituitary was activated so much that they increased their hearts than normal, became thin people, started thinking about the future, and the idea of the future started coming into the human beings. It went on till today, where the people have tried to master the five elements. They have developed ego to such an extent that they are extremely ego-oriented. And this ego anyway pushes down the superego, as you can see here. The ego that is overdeveloped can push the superego down. So then, in addition to that, people like Freud said that why should we allow ourselves to be conditioned to anything? It's only the human beings who can have good condition and who can have bad condition. But as the basic wisdom was lacking, see, gradually we started losing the basic wisdom, and we denied all kinds of conditioning within us by saying, what's wrong, what's wrong? And when we went on like this, saying, what's wrong, what's wrong? What happened was that our ego developed so much that it pushed the superego. The superego was pushed to such an extent that it could not bear it anymore. So, in the modern times, say about 15 years back, we can say about 25 years back, a new generation started showing its effects. Young generation came up and they felt that the ego is too much. We are too bound to material things. We are, instead of enslaving the matter and material powers, we are enslaved by that. This realization started coming into that. Actually started, I should say, about 60 years back. But this grew up very well about 20, 25 years back, very much, or a little earlier, we can say about 30 years back. When people started seeing that this ego is no good, this matter is dominating us, it is falsehood. But another thing they felt very strongly was that they are now not integrated to their heart. There was no joy in anything. They did things without any emotions. They were emotionless. There were no feelings for anything. It grew quite a lot, this feeling, till the war came in, Hitler tried to destroy. And at that time, with the incoming of Hitler, people could see the ego of Hitler, and they started seeing that reflection within themselves, that how Hitler could destroy this world by pampering the ego of the people by saying that you belong to a higher race and all those things. And this gave them a big shock. And this big shock made the young people of that time feel that this is not the proper way of our progress. And that's why there's a big disparity in the old people, say who ruled India, and the people who are today English citizens or who are young people there. The whole idea of ego became very subtle. They thought it was a show-off. If it overdid something, it was too formal. They believed in casual life. They wouldn't accept anything that was over-ego-oriented. But once the ego has developed too much, you cannot get out of it. The more you try to fight it, the more it will sit on you. It's not possible. And the superego is once suppressed, can be so suppressed that you just become nothing but superego, nothing but ego. And the ego then envelops the heart, because one of the auras around the heart, which I will be discussing later, is also from your Swadhisthana chakra. And the whole Swadhisthana chakra can go round and completely encompass your heart. And there is a dislocation between your heart and your head. There is a dissipation. Sometimes with shocks in life, also, a person's ego is charged. As I was telling you, that we have to be very kind to our wife and to our husband. If their ego is charged, gradually after 3-4 shocks, they get disintegrated. We give them diseases. We give them horrible things. We have no business to do these things. This is sinful. First of all, to marry someone with all the show and with all the things, and then to make somebody unhappy because you have an ego, or hurt somebody's ego by which making that person emotionally dry. Then a society which is extremely dry develops. This dry society cannot even value the children. Matter becomes the most important. Material possessions become more important. Then all human relationships are ended up and sacrificed at the altar of the sea. With this, people, after all, are human beings. They have an emotional being within them. It suffers. So to be emotional, people take to drugs and things, as I told you, to alcohols. Alcoholism grows much more with this kind of society. Just to escape the tortures of ego, they become alcoholic. Once they become alcoholic, the superego starts developing. It starts pushing the ego on one side, and the bombing starts, and the confusion starts. This alcohol, which has been denounced by every primordial master before, because they were supposed to look after your attention, because the attention not only gets spoiled, but your values too. Values about woman's chastity, values about your own chastity, values about your own dignity. I mean, you can do anything with drunkenness. I mean, people do such indignified things that if you take a photograph or even a picture of such people, they would be shocked that they were behaving like this. So first of all, the dignity, human dignity goes down. The sanctity of marriage is lost. And all the values that are built up in your attention as a human being, through all great blessings of these great saints and great prophets, drops up. One by one, you start person without any values for anything. You do not value anything but your ego. Even your material possessions are there to suggest your ego. That's how a person becomes a dry personality. In these circumstances, he thinks that he must also overpower God's powers. Sometimes such things came up that people wanted to have powers like God, and they want to challenge God. They want to say there is no God. How are we to believe there is God? Because the ego is such a blind thing that it doesn't allow you even to think about God and your relation with God. It's such a blinding thing. It makes you sometimes so stupid. As I told you last time in the seminar we had, that it really makes you absolutely stupid. Now the Vishuddhi Chakra is the thing which has started the ego. In the sense that the superego, the conditioning that was in a society, was charged by Shri Krishna. Shri Krishna was a man who was a witness of the pain. He is the one who is the primordial being. The sense, he is the one who rises to lead them home. He's the way out. And this way, Sri Krishna is the one who taught us to be devotees through Gita. Now, in short, I'll explain to you something about Gita and try to understand, because it's a very simple thing to understand Gita and to read Gita. There are, I don't know how many criticisms of Gita written already, but nobody seems to have picked up the real points of Gita. Krishna was the incarnation of divine diplomacy. Divine diplomacy. Divine diplomacy is a thing by which I also play tricks on you. Because if I cannot give you realization, if you are too argumentative, you try to be a mediocre, then I put you into such situations that you start seeing the point that you are missing the real goal. Now, Gita is nothing but is complete exposition of his talent as a diplomat. For that, one has to understand the tricks of Sri Krishna. First of all, in the very beginning, at the very outset, the second chapter in Gita, he says that you become a sthita, means you become a realized soul. You become a jnani, means a person whose awareness is enlightened. Of course, in India, as everywhere else, people think jnani means a man who's read many books. It means you should have your realization so that your awareness is enlightened. This is first thing he said. At the very outset, because he's not a businessman, you see. So he says the thing that is there. He only tells this to Arjuna, to nobody else, because he's a diplomat and he knows how people are at that time, that he's not going to tell them that he's an incarnation and that he's not going to tell them what is the truth. Because if you tell them the truth, they will hit you hard. He knew this very well. So he only tells Arjuna, who is his bhakta, who is his devotee, that you achieve that. But Arjuna at that time was a medium. He couldn't understand, because he said that you are saying you become a witness, you achieve your self-realization, and then you go for more to kill people. I can't understand, how can that be? I should kill them before, after the witnessing, how can I kill them? Even if they are poor, even if they are wrong, I cannot do it after realization, because after realization, I will have to be compassionate. This is the mediocrity of Arjuna. It's a very subtle point, I think you will catch the point. So Krishna says, he understands, he immediately understands, oh, that diplomacy is needed now. It won't work out straightforward much. Like I would say, a son is sitting out of the hut trying to drive a horse cart. Now the father comes out of the hut and the son says his cart is not moving out of it. So he said, and the first that bring the horse in front of the cart, unless and until it is connected through the horse, it won't move. You have to get connected with the horse, that is the Atma, to the spirit. So he says that you are saying that I have to move the cart, and now you are asking me to move the horse. Okay. Then father understands that this one is not going to be handled easily. So he plays a trick on him. He says, all right, let it be at the back. But you think, you believe that it is the horse which is pulling the cart. You believe it. Now how Krishna has said is even beautifully, more beautifully than this analogy. I gave you this analogy to see the trick of Sri Krishna. And he had to play, because people are so mediocre. Since the 6,000 years, they have been believing into something nonsensical that you will see now. He said, said that if I kill people, then I'll have a karma hospital. And after my realization, how will I get my realization? And if I get my realization, I cannot kill. These were his ideas about realization. What Krishna said, that you get your realization, and then whatever you do is in the name, is really in awe, fully in order with God. If you have to kill, you have to kill. You have to kill the devils, you have to kill the rakshasas. The idea that if you kill somebody is something wrong. I mean, suppose today Hitler was to come to spare him, he's very wrong. Will you spare a snake? You have to kill. And he said, nobody is killed, actually, that's the fact. Nobody does. As I told you, that the spirits prevail. So he said, only if you put them out of the state just now. So Krishna says that you should first become realized, become a witness, then you are just an instrument in the hands of God. And he uses you what he likes, and you do whatever he says. If he says you are cooking, you are cooking. If he says you don't kill, you don't kill. Because the power starts moving through you. Now, your own concept of compassion is wrong. How can you compassionate to people that one man can destroy the whole world? Why don't you be compassionate to that man? For what? The greatest compassion to him is to put him out of the world controls of his powers. This is the greatest compassion. That's what Krishna said. But as an adult, he said, still, how can I do these karmas and hear those theories? How to get rid of the karma? So Krishna played a trick again. He said, okay. He put a very absurd condition. This is what is the essence of diplomacy, is to put an absurd condition and befool a person. So that when he reaches the stage and understands that it's absurd, then he gives it up. Otherwise he will not. So he told Arjuna that, very good, you do not want realization, go ahead. You do all your karmas. And you put the fruit of the karmas at the lotus feet of the God. That's all you do, so you won't have any karmas. This is an absurd thing. Before realization, it cannot happen. It cannot happen. Before realization, your ego remains as it is, as you see. It's not subtle. Circular it will become. You think, I'm very humble, I'm very kind, and this. But you see, the ego is there. Ego is there, means it's the state of your mind which is governed with you. It has to be sucked in by some actualization and actual happening. Not as a distinct, oh, you are very humble. Some of the egoistical people are extremely humble because that's just them. Extreme. But inside is the ego there. The ego is there. Till it is sucked in, you cannot fight it, you cannot drive it out, you cannot get out. It has to be sucked in. To suck that ego, Kundalini has to rise, you have to get your realization. You have to become the self and not the ego. Your identification with ego must stop. That's only possible if you become the spirit. But he said, all right, doesn't matter. What you do is to do your karmas, like one hitting the cart. But put all your attention to the horse and your cart will move. It will never move, is the point, the absurd it is. So he gives such a proposition by which the horse does not move. And after some time you find, what is it? The cart is just there, I'm putting everything, I'm supposed to be putting everything on the horse. Nothing doing. It's not connected, it is just there. Once this conclusion is reached, then you take your realization and actualization. This is the point. Unless anything, this absurdity is dawned upon you, you will never accept it. Because you'll ask the question, why should you do it? Why should we do it? Why? So he says, all right, go ahead. So this is the karma feeling that started. Then whatever karmas you do, you put at the lotus feet of God.
make belief. He put you into a mind, into an illusion. That was important. At that stage, it was important to put you into religion, because you would not accept him. See, if you have to take out the button, you cannot do it with a straight finger, you have to make your finger bend a little. It's like that. So, Arjuna said, what about bhakti? What about devotion to God? These are all our organized religions, churches, and our temples and all. What about that? Till that also, he was very careful. He said, in Sanskrit, pushpam phalam bhavet, whatever is the fruit, whatever is the flower, or whatever is the water you give me, I take. I take whatever. If you give me a flower, I take. But while giving, he's very careful, which I don't know if people have seen the point or not. He says, while giving, he says, and that you do ananya bhakti, devotion, that is ananya. Now the word ananya is the word which is the real Tibetan word, ananya. It means when you are not the other, when you are realized. You can only do bhakti when you are realized, ananya. The person who is ananya means the one who is not the other. You become one with God. Then you do the bhakti. Very clearly said that you do ananya bhakti. Ananya devotion means devotion when you are not the other, when you are realized. Before that, what is the devotion? Very clearly said, but nobody sees the point. We have seen people, the other day a gentleman came from a cult who just means Shri Rama, Shri Krishna, Shri Rama, Shri Krishna. This is not ananya bhakti. Ananya bhakti means when there is no other, means you become realized. This is the essence of his bhakti yoga. In bhakti yoga, he has said that you have to become one with your spirit also by saying ananya. And by karma, karma yoga is also the same, that whatever work you do, you put at the Buddha's feet of the Lord, you cannot do it, absolutely. But after realization, what happens to you, that you do not say, I do it. You say, it's going, it's coming, it's rising, it's happening, it hurts. It's, you just say, I'm getting the Buddha, you don't say, never. It is coming, because you know you are not, you feel that, because it's going from you, you have become all of us. You say, it is going, it is coming, it is not coming, you don't say, I have given realization to myself, what will you do? Like a lady came with me to America, and she told me that Mother, you must give realization to my son. So not, huh? And he came all the way from Honolulu. And the Kundalini was frozen to him, right? She said, Mother, please give him realization. I said, you are a realization, you try, you treat. Or give him a certificate that he is a realization. He said, how can I know he's not? And why not? It would be good idea, you are teaching mind and body to leave me, giving realization, you will realize. Why don't you say you are realized? If I were you, I would say, Baba, you are realized, get out from here, because I'm ready. The Kundalini doesn't try. It's a frozen Kundalini. I said, why don't you do it? She said, Hasan, I know she is not realized. It doesn't give vibration. So, and I say that. I said, that's what it is. The Kundalini has to rise. That means you know that it is beyond your ego. It is beyond your ego. We cannot reach. You must have that authority in you, then only you can do it. As long as there is no authority. You are doing it, that's why that is ego means an illusion that you are doing something. Because you don't know anything, what do you do? As I told you, all dead work. Then to the dead. Make a chair, staircase, oh, you are a great man. Stones you bring from the mountains, make another mountain, oh, you are a great architect. All these are dead energies you are managing, electricity, magnetism, are electricities. All these things are not living energies. Living energy is the synthesis energy of all the energies, which is prana, on the right hand side. On the the left hand side is the mana, and in the center is the dharma. All these three energies are synthesized, are integrated actually, because synthesis is a separate, it doesn't mean dead to the dead, but we can say it's completely integrated when the light of the spirit comes to you. And this is the Brahma, is the one that is going from your mind. This is the Brahma, is the Brahma. So this was about me. But in his childhood, what did he do? We have to understand. In his childhood, people say he did not try something. No, it was not. As I knew from my very childhood, he knew from his very childhood. He played with the gopis when he was about 4 years of age. There's a guru who says he's Shri Krishna. That's why he makes you like that. Imagine he was 4 years of age and this guru is, I think, 50 years of age. Is it the same? In fact, 4 years age, like an innocent child, he just tried to make one naked because he wanted to waste their kundalini as a child. He could climb. You imagine my grandson does that. He climbs on the backs of the people and makes them into a slide to make the kundalini rise. He does it many a times. He uses them as a slide and that's the best way. And I told him, why don't you do it in your village? He said, but where will I get these feet? I must have your feet there. Otherwise, what's the use of making sliding them down? So, the child of 4 years played with the gopis. When they were carrying the small pots with water on their necks, he would break the pot. Because Ram is the Chi Dham is the one who sustains. Ram Dham. She's the Mahalakshmi. Ram Dham. The one who sustains the village. She used to have a bath in the river Jamuna and used to vibrate the water. And the gopi, the lady, used to go and fill their pitchers in that water, which was a vibratory water. And he would just break that pitcher from the back. So the water would fall from the back. You may awake into the water. See the trick of the child. Because in those days there was no matter at all. Not such gold seekers, one could not talk of seeking in a village of Gurgul. So he tried these tricks of making the pitcher, make the water fall on the back, so that the woman may not be there. Then he had also his gopis and goats used to hold their hands. It's called Ram. So Ram is there, so to speak. Ram used to be there. She's there, but she used to hold her hands, and they used to hold them, and the energy used to pass through them. But she was the incarnation of energy, and he was the incarnation of the primordial being. That's different. Nowadays, you find people hold on your hands and fall through the space. Well, it's horrible. It is satanic. Such a thing should be never be done, which causes lots of problems, mentally, physically, in every way, especially. What if it's the hardest stuff to do, like this whole hands and balls of spirits, or some sort of a dead Babaji sitting in Himalaya or Tibet or someone? If they are near our souls, they will never. Because they understand this. They will never come in. They will never come this. Now, when you understand that she was Radha and the energy was passing to them, they again have the last. And used to play another thing very beautiful, is to climb over a little bit made up of the wall and talk to get some butter for the people to eat, and the mother will hang it high so that they don't reach their feet. Used to take a small little stick and hit it, and all the butter used to flow by they eat the and they want you to share. His father's mark and show the truth of the butter. Why do you do that? First of all, standing on top of their dress is to start the rest of the world. There was a gentleman who watched the realization in California. He was
so it's a different allegiance to him. The same man of my father was the student of the time, he was the chief. Very interesting, I was an engineer. He had never learned about Shri Krishna, he didn't know all that.
And before getting realization, he went into his subconscious areas, and then he finds him playing with Shri Krishna. And he describes this to him, made like a pyramid, all these things, and how he falls down. And then he saw other things also there, which you can read the book and see yourself. But butter, Shri Krishna is very fond of butter. Why? It is at this point. You need butter for your sheep. If you have got sinus trouble, you heat some butter and take a dropper and pour the heated butter in the nose regularly. For 3-4 days, your sinus will cure. It's a very simple medicine, you just try it. Your colds will cure. Why? Because the inner membrane of the nose with our breathing becomes very, very rough, or we can say cracked, as our hands can get cracked. Now, if the butter is put, say, even on the soup spread, we used to do before, nowadays people have become so butter conscious that they don't put it. On the soup, you see the butter on the soup just goes and lines up the trachea and all these places and the throat and these glands. Even the ischial tube is lined up. See, so that the whole thing becomes very much soft. Even if you have any problem, you can rub hot butter in here. Now the butter has double quality. It is a soft milk, but plus salt. Salt is the quality of the gurus. So it's a combination of guru and the butter. As we gargle with the salt, osmosis takes. It has a very deep significance. Now, this center is manifested outside, as I told you, by 16 subplexuses, which cover our nose, eyes, throat, our neck, ears, and also the outside of our eyes, the eyelids, and also if we muscles that control, and so many things by this one set. 60 are the petals also of this center, Vishuddhi Chakra. Vishuddhi means without, Vishuddhi means, V means absence of. I mean, it is so Shuddha, it is so holy that everything is absent. Vishuddha is the meaning of this tender. He is absolutely holy. And that's why he is a Sakshi, he is a witness. He tried to break our conditions in a different way from Freud. First conditioning we had in those days, that a wife and a husband relationship was too conditioned. And wife was dominated by husband, by all family people, and they used to torture and everybody. In his time, a woman was treated just like a slave in the house in those days. Somehow it worked out. Because women supposed to be very chaste, had to be very good. While the man was dominating, and it was a big family system that developed. And with this, people started getting stronger in that family system, which had become dead. So he wanted to flout all that nonsense. He said that there is no harm in mixing with men as brothers and sisters. We have to be pure in heart, and they are not brothers and sisters. We should mix up, and we should have proper relationship with each other, understanding that this is my wife, this is my husband, and others are my brothers and sisters. Because it was not allowed for any woman even to get out of houses in those days. It was so much just reduced because the mother-in-laws were very strong and they would not allow the daughters to go in. The whole episode of Krishna and Gokul is like this. And all the stories and songs are like that, that a wife says to the husband, oh, my sister-in-laws are away, how can I get her back from her soon? So all the story of love between husband and wife, can start. Now, he didn't have so many yogis as I have today, and disciples around. And he had to permeate his powers, the 16,000 powers he had at this chakra. This chakra is represented here to the head, in front. His body as Viraha's chakra, means the one he will be, where he become the primordial. So, to have those 16,000 conducting human beings, he had to play a drum. He was a great drummer. He made them take birth as women. And he got them arrested by a king. Now a social problem was created. These women were with that man. So if, according to Indian standards, they are all finished. They have no man. They are all born women. Though they were by force taken, not with their own willing, but in India, any woman who is even taken by force at the time of Sita, it has happened. So she should be discarded, as Rama did, as I told you last time. So he attacked his king and got all the 16,000 with him. So people said, you have 16,000 women who are not to be accepted in the society. What will you do? Then nobody is going to marry. He said, I'll marry them. But he told them his pre-plan. See, actually, they were his powers. And he married them. He said, I'll marry 16,000. It's not a play. See, it's the play of the Viraha. He married those 16,000. Now, the five elements that he wanted to control, he said, I want to go on them. We have to have them embodied in some. So he created five women. And he married them also. Now many people say, oh, Krishna would marry 16,000 and he had five queens and this and that. Are you Shri Krishna? Are you Virat? Have you got even one power to flow through? If you have one, you can flow through yours. He's the one with 16,000 powers. And these powers are created on this earth to give us an awareness by which we felt that there is God beyond. That there is a magic force. That we have to achieve that whole service. That we have to become a witness of the play of the whole. He made us conscious of magic force at that time. He said in Gita that the spirit that is within you never dies. It again and again comes back to give you realization, and when you die, the spirit does not die. Nainam chidanti shastrani, nainam dhati pavaka, na chaidam tledayam kyapu nisho sayadima. You cannot kill it with a weapon. Neither you can burn it with fire, neither wind can blow it off, neither anything can suck it. To prove this, Christ came on this earth. To prove what Krishna had said, Christ came on this earth to show that spirit is eternal. They are all one together. We are the people who cannot see them as them. And sometimes it shocks people when I tell them about the relationship of Shri Krishna and past his souls. Christ, the name Christ came from the word Christ. And Krishna were means the form. That means Krishna came on this earth to sow the seed. Created by Radha, who was such an energy, came on this earth as the mother of Christ. Christ's mother was a lady who lived like a potent energy for Christ. Except for him, nobody knew. That's why at the cross he says, "Behold the mother." That's very important. And he was one of the greatest sons you can think of, to your mother. Radha incarnated on this earth. And she brought this immaculate conception. The whole story about it is in the Devi Mahatmya, where the goddess created Mahavishnu out of an egg. And that's why on the Easter we celebrate the egg. Egg is the suggestion of you being the egg and the next birth. Easter suggests the second birth of human beings. The name Jesus also comes from the word Yashoda. Yashoda was the foster mother of Sri Krishna, and Radha thought that her name must be brought in, but she was also another power. So Yashoda is called also as Jasoda in the northern parts, where Krishna lived. She was called actually like Jasoda. And the small form of Jasoda is Jesu. And that's why it was called as Jesu or Yesu. In Indian languages he is called as Yesu, never as Jesu. And even in Hebrew he is called as Yesu, not as Jesu. You see, this Y and J, like Yugoslavians and all these people use, is a confusion between Y, Y and J. And these two words are confused in the word Yesu or Jesu. He gave him such powers, according to Devi Mahatmya, that he became the supreme support. He is the support at the Muladhara Chakra. He is the one who is Ganesha at Muladhara Chakra. He is the support of the whole universe. And Krishna placed him higher than himself because he incarnated higher than him. And Sri Krishna is. If I am saying the truth, you will get the vibrations first. Just see on the vibration. The crucifixion of Christ, which I will tell you later on, is another drama. It's another drama to be played. Now see the difference between the 6,000 years and 2,000 years of Christ. So the 4,000 years passed in between. In that 4,000 years, lots of things were to be decided, and it was decided that Christ should be born in Jerusalem, in these places. Bethlehem, we can call near Jerusalem. Because that was the place which was to be attacked again by the divine forces. And always, most of these primordial masters, they are called as gurus, they are born in that area. Even Zoroaster, you see, most of these people like Muhammad Sahib, three Zoroasters, one after another, three of them gave one personality in class. Then Muhammad Sahib came in there, Moses came in, Abraham came in, all these people were born in that area. And then Christ came to culminate it. They thought that would be the best place where these great primordial masters have worked, that they respect Christ and that they will be able to understand him. The people as they are, they killed Muhammad Sahib, but they also killed Christ. They never listened to Moses, they never listened to Christ. People are like that. And today I find many people who call themselves Christians are the people who were there to enjoy his crucifixion, who liked it, supported it, and crucified him. Today they are moving with the Bible in their hand and saying that this is this, this is this. So unauthorized. So dangerous. Now, it is better sometimes to read what Krishna has to say about Christ. But just now, today, as we are first dealing with the Vishuddhicharana, I'll talk about Christ later. Vishuddhicharana has two other points which are very important within us. I have to take this up because you people are suffering from left Vishuddhi. Left Vishuddhi is on the left hand side and right on the right hand side. Right hand side Vishuddhi is the Vishuddhi where when he was the king and called as Vichala and his wife Rukmini, they had that path. This is the Raja, or you can say the Rajasa, means the kingliness or the Rajaguna is called as what? Action. Then he went into action as a king, is on the right hand side. The left hand side is the one when he was born and his early life when he had a sister. The sister was actually the daughter of Yashoda, was sacrificed. It was a big story. How Krishna was born in a jail and was taken by his father and put it in another place called Gokul. And the child in that place was a girl, was sent, and she is the one who appears as the lightning in there. And how she became the lightning when she was killed and announced that your killer is still alive to the horrible Rakshasa, who was actually the brother of Krishna's mother. And it was announced that the eighth child of this Devaki, his sister, this Kamsa's sister, Kamsa is the Rakshasa, is a devil, will kill him. And this frightened him so much that he started killing all the children that were born to this Devaki, his sister, who was put in the jail. The last one was Sri Krishna, and when he was born, everybody stepped off. And the doors opened out, and his father carried him in a basket, just like Moses to the Indus, and crossed the river Yamuna. And when the river touched Sri Krishna's feet, it again went down, crossed over, went to Gokul, put the child there, took the child of Nan Yashoda, and brought the child back and replaced it. When the child was replaced, you see, it was a girl. So Kamsa came and said, you say, oh, the eighth is a girl, how can it be? So then he just heard the girl and she went up and she announced that the killer of you, Kamsa, is born there and is living very much and he is going to, kill you. Beware. And then the story is that how he tried to kill him. So that we forget about that. But the main thing I'm telling this was the sister of Sri Krishna. Now the left Vishuddhi problem starts when we get confused about sisters' relationship. All the pure relationships like a mother. This is Mr. Freud's blessings. All kinds of confusions, creative problems about relationships with other men, other women. There's no understanding. Anyone who's married, unmarried, anything, to cast eyes towards her, to have a religious eyes towards her. That's why Christ at this point had to say, because he's connected with eyes, that's why he said, that thou shalt not have a religious eyes. But that's not possible without realization, I've seen it, when we have advanced so much in this thing. So all these perverse ideas about men and women's relationship are there, and in the subconscious they create a kind of a guilt. You know it's wrong. You know in the base of your heart you know. But the ego is gone so much that people say, what's wrong? That's why I say people in the West are at least innocent. They know it is not wrong. But in the East, In India, when people know it is wrong, still they did wrong, means they are not innocent people at all. They know this is wrong and still they did, then they are not innocent. So all those Indians who try to do these things knowingly that it is wrong are the wrong type of people because they have lost their innocence. Now, this is one of the things why we catch on the leadership very much in the West. But the second one is even another thing is just to sit down and analyze yourself. This is a basically is some sort of a funny sort of a gift that is built in us. Or sometimes it is a super ego, some sort of possession and you start analyzing and just murdering yourself quietly. I should not have said this. Why did I do it? I should not have gone there. I should not have said. Maybe it is Catholicism, could be anything. Jews also go and weep and they go and repent into things. And when you have repented, finish them. If you have repented, then it is finished. Why then you all still carry on with the guilt within you? And this left side, it's too much. So much that my hand gets really paralyzed with the vibration going all the time. It's left side. That's why I say, you go on saying one mantra, I am not guilty, I am not guilty, I am not guilty. Because you go on suggesting to yourself that you are not guilty. All the time sitting down and analyzing yourself. And also, this, the society is like this. From the very beginning, you are told, you should not have done this, you should have been there. This you should not have done, this carpet is spoiled, that is spoiled, this. So the whole thing builds like a guilt. For nothing at all, you are guilty of such a fake stuff. And you believe in that, and the gurus play on it. They say these are your karmas, so you are doomed to give it. So on the left you should be, you have this guilt business. On the right you should be, you are extremely talkative. And you are very arrogant. Such people can create orators. They can shout at the top of their voices. They can control people with their oratory. The right side is making that kind of an action to their sound. There's so many things one has to say about how the sound comes in, how it becomes a vehicle and all that, but let it be more complicated. So now, this is how we develop the complications of the left and the right. When the center is upset, then you take the responsibility of everything. You are running like a mad horse. You are like a bull, I should say. And you do all the bull's job and you think, oh, you are such a nice man. In your heart. You feel, oh, I will help that. Oh, I get it. I'll do it. You take the responsibility of the whole world upon your head and start saying, oh, I feel so bad that I could not help in Vietnam. You cannot help. How are you connected? I'm so bad about Cambodia. I should have done something. You cannot do it. You're just sitting here in Australia, you have to look after Australian problems, Sydney problems, family problems, and your own problems. Start from there, charity begins at home. People always try to see the problems of other people. Like if I'm there, they will tell me, why there is poverty in India? Anyway, very seriously ask me. I said, who is responsible for our poverty, please? Then, why don't you think of your own problems? When I'm in an Australian out and out. When I'm in India, I'm Indian out and out. Why am I Indian? I'm English. That's how you should be an Australian to face your problems. What are your problems? And these are your problems. That you feel guilty for nothing at all. The condition is like that. And then, if you get out of the way, you become egoistical. You say, I hate you, and when you follow the offering, really bark. There's no softness anymore. Such a horrible voice starts coming that I know about Australians fighting. When you take to drinking, you go to the other end. I mean, when we were coming to Australia in the plane, they were drinking so much and talking so much after that, nobody could sleep even for a minute. And so long they were talking that I was thinking even fish market in Bombay is better than that.
And they have lost all capacity to understand that there are people who want to sleep. And they are talking so loudly that if, like there was a mouthpiece on the near their lips, the way they went on and on and on, all of them talking very loud. You go to any reception, you don't hear anything, you talk, all right. But the other one doesn't listen to you, you don't listen to him. They all talk, very loud. You just don't know what they are talking, what you are talking. They say, yes, few nods there and few nods here. And you don't know what they are talking, what they are saying. And they think, oh, they are going to a reception. Then you come out again and go another reception, serve us all. Then you go, Yaranam, such and such, come on, you go, shake hands. Such as self-presenting, what is the need? There's no awe, there's no rapport, there's no understanding. And if there is, it is flirting. That's all. Which is another, as I told you, is nothing but is a play of the spirits through your eyes. That's why Christ had saw him and he said, thou shalt not have adulterous eyes. Thou shalt not have adulterous eyes. Any Christian who has adulterous eyes should know that the first step to Christianity is not. He said it so very clearly and emphatically to you to understand that your eyes are very important and they have to be pure. They have to be honest and pure eyes. I like the way people in Australia like my honesty of telling them everything that is honest. It's so sweet of you. Because some things can be quite hard to believe and to take in. Though I do speak softly about them, I'm very clever to put it through. But the way you see it, because perhaps you see that honesty in me. I'm not here to please you or to displease you, but to tell you the truth. In such a way that you do not get a shock and you start absorbing it. Because that is what you are asking for. So at this stage, the awareness becomes collectively conscious. Started becoming collectively conscious. This is the beginning of that. But now the incoming Buddha Christ, Advent of Christ, was especially that. Thousands of years back, it was back then. It was greeted with the pranama, the omkara, the logos as you call it, the sound that is the complete energy of omkara. The word, you can see the word. He is that energy embodied. Because he had to prove that the spirit is eternal, he is the spirit. And all his centers, he's there. His vibrations are nothing but emission or manifestation of his being. So he cannot be king because he's spirit. He cannot be dead. He cannot be destroyed. Because it's just the energy of spirit. That was the embodiment of Christ. And he was brought on this earth. And he was crucified, so to speak, of him. This gate here, he had to penetrate. This very important gate here, which is the Agya Chakra, which he had to penetrate. By penetrating this, he created a space in the ego and the superego. This space is the space where they say that Christ is the one who has taken the sins of human beings. He's the lamb that was sacrificed. In the olden Indians, they used to sacrifice lamb. If you have done anything bad, bring a lamb and sacrifice it at the altar of the gods. Those who do not know about Christ are sleeping it. And those who know about Christ also sacrificing Christ again. So the karma theory finishes off at the point where Christ lived. Because he is the one who is capable of sucking your ego and superego. On one side he sucks your ego, on the other side he sucks your superego. He is the one who drove. He drove the spirits into the pigs and the pigs ran into the sea. I mean he did so many such things, but because of these disciples, he is not depicted fully. But he so clearly showed that there are spirits and that we have nothing to do with the dead. But the Christians who call themselves Christians are just anti-Christ in this respect. They have all the dead bodies in the church, you are sitting on the layers of dead bodies. All the spirits hovering around, your children are attacked and you are not attacked. I am not against the church. Church, if it is for the realized souls, it's a very weak thing. There's no reality in a church where they do not have Christ with them. Christ is the Spirit. If the church tries hard to be reborn, then it is a church. Otherwise, the rest of the things are just lip services. They are lip services. Now, another thing, all the Christian nations are very much interested in all kinds of these dead things, like clairvoyances. Oh, I'm told there are some clairvoyances, they're very, very flourishing people. It's very dangerous to go near them. Cancer. Blood cancer. Epilepsy. Heart attacks. Accidents. Financial ruin. All those things can come to you through these mediums. They have no control over them. They say, she's very good lady, he's very good gentleman. He may be good or bad, but what about the ones which are coming in? Can you see them? Do you know who are coming? It's like an immigration without any passes, without any visas. Why go to the dead? But the Christian nations, I was about England, this is supposed to be the heart of the world. Every 10th house, somebody sitting with a blanket, talking to the great-grandfather to know where is he generating the property or some sort of thing. Every 10th house, you see, and so much, then the whatever was less there was completed by our Gurus from India. Some of them came out of the jail, they had no place to go, they wore those dresses and went down. To my friend, some of them are strawberries. They are strawberries. And they became Gurus. Whatever they taught is horrible Hindi or horrible Marathi or whatever it is. Besides, for poor English. English addressed us politically, openly, oriented. But these are Eastern slimy from super ego. And these gurus are making him dance. There is one who wants Rolls Royce. Last time he asked for the Rolls Royce. He has got 58, he wanted a 59. Actually he was going to buy 3 ships, but somehow it fizzled out. And that sort of people are there. And these very boys, English people, who do not eat their food without the teeth, coats, are held by their tails, by these horrors. Without knowing how much they are issued, and even grown-ups and old elderly lords are in it. There was one lord who died, Lord Sun, who died. He was trying to fly there. The father was with father and mother downstairs. Father about 70 years of age and wife about 65 were trying to fly. Downstairs and upstairs was the daughter-in-law and the son. And the son collapsed. He died. So the lady, the wife came and told that he's dead. So they were very happy. He's now gone to heaven. He's achieved his last. Imagine his loss. He's scholarly lords. And some sadhus went to tell him, he said, don't tell us, don't come in our happiness and joy. Our son has gone to heaven and we are all going to go there. Can't understand this. What has happened to those brains? They are told that you take a drum, stand on Oxford Street, wear that horrible dress, go on dancing to that God's name, and begging, then you'll go to God. How can you believe such nonsense? And for smile, I must tell you, I had 6 of them, all scholars, turned into these scholars from Oxford and from Cambridge. Oxford, you know, 4th car combined with an ox. They really completely exhausted me. 4 years I worked on them. I said, oh God, these stones, what am I to do with them? They liked the food I cook, they liked the house I lived, they liked the way I was, everything, but nothing happened to the Kundalini. And then it happened. Very difficult nuts to break, but now, then they went up, all spontaneous. They found out that Sergio, it is pointed to Sergio. Everything points to Sergio, everything points to Kundalini Amity. It's there. They recognize him logically. Absolutely logical. This is wonderful. I am here because of that, I should say. They always felt they have a guilt about Australia. That they ill-treated people for very little offenses, like even stealing the bread and all that. They sent away these people here. Now I feel thank God you are here. It's a heaven. You got heaven's punishment compared to that dirty London nowadays. It's nice to go and see every time you go out, you have to have an umbrella, even people play football with an umbrella in their hand. It's a mad place, precariously placed, I don't know. But it is the heart of the everything circulates from there. All your laws, all your governing things, everything comes from there. So, I have to work very hard, I know. But now we have really beautiful surgeries, which are tremendously. And thanks to William Blake, he has already prophesied so much about surgery. About what will happen, even where I lived, where ashram will be, everything so much in details that now things are getting very much better in India. So now we come back from there to our Agya Chakra, the center where Christ came in. There is ego and superego. He came at a point which is in the center of the ego and superego, which is controlled by the pituitary, the ego is controlled, and the pineal body controls the superego. In between them, and the optic chiasma, the center of the optic chiasma in the ear. That's why eyes are very important for me, because eyes are controlled by the center. There are 2 pedals to that, hum, cha. These are the 2 sounds that come out of those 2 pedals, hum, cha. On one side, third side, when the person is in super. Masochist, which they call them, people of masochist. Who like domination, who like beating up and all. I mean, the extreme cases. I mean, in India, we do not have this extreme type. We have people who are submissive, or we have people who are arrogant at the most. But this, the husband beating the wife with a hunter, or women, and some women like me. This kind of nonsense, I have not heard of. But you see, you go to such extremes in everything you want to sort out. All right. If we have to be suppressed, all right. Let us get beatings. Go on suffering. Why should you suffer? Christ has suffered for you. What is the need for you to suffer? I just don't understand. And make a drama out of it. We are suffering. Ladies are arguing. Like the French. French are ladies are arguing. Bore very difficult people, you know, you can't carry on. They think their game is rather making everybody miserable. In the same way, we also take to this kind of an idea, oh, we are suffering, we are very unhappy people. We start all sorts of nonsensical emotional dramas we play. And why are you laughing? Why are you enjoying yourself? Like I went to France, I told you, they told me, mother, don't say that you are a happy person. They won't like it, they'll think you are not sensitive. But really? Then I made a big fun out of the whole stuff. But this is what it is. We go to the extreme. We torture ourselves. We go on condemning ourselves. Oh, I'm so bad. I'm good for nothing. I'm useless. We had a gentleman like that. He did only one thing, is to leave Lord Byron. That man, he should never be flattered. What a life he had. He himself was a horrible, licentious man, and he writes about prisoner in China. This Lord Byron, he did. Now he became the prisoner, you see. Without any prison, without anything. He's the prisoner, he's Mr. His name is Ronnie. And Ronnie means the one who cries in Indian language, Ronnie. So this Mr. Ronnie, all the time used to cry, he sleep in his bed, have his food in his bed, I'm very sorry, I'm this and that. My mother got fed up. Wife ran away, also he was crying for that. The son ran away, crying from that. The mother said that you can have your son, so he's crying from that. She doesn't love me. Then he came to me, he said, mother, I would like to wash your kitchen. And I said, you see, there is no need. I have got my own people here, staff, you don't have to play. Now will you please change your attitude towards life? He said, mother, I'll try this, I'll try it, and the realization tried it. But he has these habits. I said, all right, we sent him back to his mother. 3 days later, she rang me up that you please take your son away from me. I'm fed up of him. He's come here, he's sleeping in his bed as usual, he's gone back to the same, and he's doing no work, I have to cook for him, otherwise he starves himself, and he thinks he's the most miserable man, you better have him. You see, this is the substance of people. It's the super ego people on one side. The another are the aggressive. Actually, the very aggressive people can become also people, because they are afraid of the evil. Like in England, I was surprised, people are very frightened, very frightened. Extremely frightened people, you know, Indians are not like that. I mean, if you need anything, you better telephone to them and go to their house. Otherwise, if you go and knock at their door, they might die of heart failure. They are so frightened, it's more surprising. Extremely frightened people. You cannot say anything to them, they just get like this. What are they frightened about? I don't understand. Extremely frightened people they are. In India it is not so. In India, supposing somebody knocks you at the night. Immediately you came. Oh, maybe your friend has come, he may be in difficulties. Immediately the husband would ask the wife, you have sufficient money in the house? Have you got? Or have you got some ornaments? You may need some money, otherwise why has he come? Or maybe some problem with him. It's like that. You just open the door immediately without thinking. That, and the thieves in India don't knock at the door and come in. I mean, there are not expert burglars, you see, as we are meaning. They are naive still. So their thieving also is mostly of no value. Actually, in my household, in my father's house, we never knocked on the houses, never. All our doors were open morning to evening. My father said, if you lock the house, the people will think there's something in the house, that's why it's locked. Please keep it open. We leave everything open, anybody can walk in, and in the night, nobody takes it. I mean, we were like that. But now we have learned how to thieve and how to do things. And that's why the problem is different. All right, so we have Christ in this place, where this red mark, sitting at the crossing point. Sitting at the crossing point. And this crossing point he has done for us. He has taken our karmas, the sins, upon himself. The Hindus should now realize that they need not go about with their karma theory before leaving the river. They do not want to talk of Christ because they know their karma theory fails. If he has been sacrificed for our sins, either he was a false guru or they are true gurus, then how can we build up our karmas? If we become the spirit, all our karmas will be certified fast, who is awakened in that. So all the karma theories go away, all the sacrifices go away, all these ideas must go away. And when I talk about these things, Hindus blame me that you are a Christian. And when I talk about Krishna, the Christians say that you are a Hindu. Some say I am a Muslim, some say I am. Oh, what am I? I am everything else. Because I know all of them are one, in one body, in one personality. They all exist in one personality, in every human being. And no use disintegrating them and suffering the problems of disintegration. I am a Christian, I am a Muslim, I am a Muslim. You are that because you are born of that. Do you think about it? You accepted it just because you were born of that. What have you got out of that? What did your forefathers say? All your people have been going to the same thing. You are a Hindu, you are going like a Hindu to Jesus. If you are a Christian, you are going like a Christian to Jesus. If you are a Muslim, you are going like a Muslim family. It's all that nonsense. You have been doing it for ages together. Did you get your realization is the first point? Even in the Gita, the first thing he said is that if through Veda, Veda word means to know. Veda means to know. And Veda means by which you know. If these Vedas cannot make you know, then they are useless. They themselves are confessed. So, we see here Christ standing at the gate of three centers, three powers. Mahakali, Mahalakshmi, Mahasaraswati. He's the one who is controlling all these three powers within us. By one power, he controls all our super egos, he controls all the devils and spirits. If you show the cross, the devils run out. It's common. He controls our ego on the right hand side. Though the Christians are the most ego-oriented. Whatever they profess, they are just the opposite of that. And then he controls the dharma within us by which he makes us rise above to our spiritual level, to be our spirit. He controls that center within us. And this center is the center where your eyes become pure. That your super ego at the back is clear. That your ego is sucked in. And from your eyes flows nothing. But just compassion. Just compassion. And love of God. And the devotees have adoration. And nothing. One lecture is not sufficient to describe Christ, nor it is sufficient to describe Sri Krishna. I have spoken for hours, days together, and this lecture has taken too much time because I have tackled two very important centers together. I hope you will not sit on certain words or certain thoughts and just try to denounce the truth. This is the truth. I have come here to tell you the truth. I am not to please you. Your ego, to please your ego or to excite your superego, but to comfort and to make you yourself, your spirit. May God bless you.
You have been asking too many questions. You better come and see me. All right? That will be better because you must be satisfied.
Thank you.
All right? Just too many questions also. Why? Just take it. First of all, get realization. Get realization. Did you read the book and when?
Yes. Which one?
Advent.
Advent. Nine, nine.
Any questions? Anti-visualization, have you developed? You went to a certain stage where you developed, as he calls it, cosmic consciousness. Do you live in a cosmic consciousness?
What is cosmic? It's not cosmic. Cosmic is has to something to do with your five elements.
Hello, just a minute. I'll tell you. Sit down. You see, cosmic consciousness is a consciousness which develops when you have interest in the matter. Cosmic consciousness, part of it is shown now by your knowledge of science. This is the cosmos. The spirit has nothing to do with the cosmos. In the sense that this matter is just a lamp for the light. Light is the spirit. This so-called cosmic consciousness is actually achieved by the movement of the mind to the right-hand side, which is the supra-conscious area. In this movement, before realization, you are helped by people who are busybodies, who are ambitious people, who are lying on the right-hand side. Like, you feel you are flying there, you are living in your body, you are sitting on a tree, or suddenly drowsy. Some people are drowsy, they know about the water, where the water is. Also, these suggestions come to you from the supra-conscious area. Sometimes you start knowing about certain stars. There are supra-conscious people in Colombia, where? Very many. Even this LSD, and there are some drugs like that, if you take, you go into supra-conscious area. You start seeing colors and formations. Beyond that, also, these people are so surprisingly supra-conscious. You'll be amazed that I asked them, why do you have an emblem of your Navy? Emblem of your Navy as the control, the Garuda, the big eagle. They said that it is because our old Indians told us that one Indian is from Bharat, from India, God, called Vishnu, came on a condor to this country. I mean, they are that much precious. So, that kind of a development is not necessary now. That time is over. When people wanted to build up the right side, they tried to create their knowledge on the right side, like using prana, then using all these five elements, the Vedas and all. Now you are developed, your ego is developed, alright. Now the time of development is such that you have to become the spirit. You don't have to, you don't need it. By your knowledge of cosmic consciousness only, you discover the ether, you discover the gravity, you discover so many things. Now all these things that you have discovered are going to help the surgeon. It's meant for this time. Like you made a stage. For the stage you put lights, you put all adjustments for sound, everything. But the people who have to be on the stage are you. Your job is to be on the stage. You are not to bother about the stage arrangements. That's all done. That's all finished. Now, you see this mind, which looks such a simple thing. You know, with this mind, on this magnetic emission, I can put the spiritual power to you. As I told you, it is the lamp that bears the light. So this is a carrier. If I put it here, like this, say I put it here. When I talk, you can hear me the same way as if you are hearing me.